If you're somebody that wants to get into audiobook narration, whether it's by narrating the audiobooks, or if you were interested in dabbling and becoming an author and then having other people read your books, then this video is for you. In this video, I'm revealing the author of the books that I narrated. This is the first time that she and I ever spoke. I'm asking her the questions that a lot of you want to know the answers to. So get ready to take notes and watch out for these gems that are going to be dropped in this video, because she's not only helping narrators by letting us know what she's looking for, but also what goes into getting these books available for us to narrate and being an author. So before we get into the video, I just want to give you a quick heads up that this is a shortened version of the entire interview. If you are interested in the full uncut interview, then make sure you click the link below this video for my audiobook blueprint course, because there is a full uncut version where you get all the gems in there. Now, without further ado, I'm as excited as you are to reveal the author. So let's get to the video. Hey, hey! So we are here with the much anticipated interview. For those of you that may be new to my channel or may not know what's going on, I have the author of the books that I have been narrating that so many of you have been asking about. I have her here and in the flesh. So first of all, I want to say thank you so much for coming. Her name is Sin, and I'm going to let Sin introduce herself.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. I'm like so excited to do this. And to finally meet you, like,
yes.
So we've been working together for like, what, 2 years now? And
three years.
Oh,
yes,
my God.
It's 2020. Yep.
Girl, and we have yet to like we'll like text. We text all the time. We'll voice message, but we have yet to like actually like I've never seen her face before. Like I've heard her voice, never seen her face. Yes, hey y'all. I am Sin, or Sin Alexander. And yeah, I have a ton of books, and a few of which Nikki has been so amazing to record for me for audiobook. I've even pulled her out of retirement to do a few books for me. I was like, please do this for me. And yeah, that's me.
How many books do you have in that you've written so far that have been published?
Yes, ma'am. So I this sounds so bad. I need to know this answer, but it's above 25, under 30.
What?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So you actually have narrated probably my most popular series. There's one other series that you did not do that is up there with The Family. But you have really kind of grasped the ones that are really like popping. But yeah, I have about between 25 and 30 books published.
That is insane. So how do you come up with these ideas for these characters? Because when I'm narrating them, I'm reading these books and I'm like, what? Especially the last one. I'm not going to give anything away, but the last one, the way that it ended, I'm like, ooh,
yeah,
what's going to happen next? Like, where do you come up with these ideas? Like, do you just like embody these characters, or like, how do you?
So I'll talk about, I actually will talk about Billion Dollar Baddie first. Because Anything for the Family is actually like a really different story for me. And so I'll tap into that. But Billion Dollar Baddie is probably more like how ideas come to me. So for that one, I actually got that idea from another author. So we were actually, shout out to Shay Jones. Me and her actually came up with this idea where we were like, I'm gonna do this face off where we both wrote a story about like a billion-dollar female. So like we wanted it to be like really female forward, like strong female lead. Yes, girl boss, period.
That's right.
And that's where that idea came from. And a lot of the time my ideas just really come from inspiration, whether it's just talking to other authors or watching movies or like even just like hearing conversation like on the street. Like I just pull from anywhere. I just got back from New York and that was my first time on the East Coast ever. And so like I pulled so much from that experience. Like my next book is now going to be set in Harlem. So like it just, it really just depends. But for the family, I don't know if you knew this or not, but that series, that book, the book one was the first book I ever started writing, like when I was 18. Oh, so this is like, this is like, you know, 15 years ago. And I never finished it. It took me like 10 years to finish the book. I put out other books before I finished that book. And so those characters really like marinated with me for 10 solid years before I ever published anything. And I feel like you can really tell because there's so much happening. It's so in depth. So
yeah, I couldn't tell. I really couldn't tell. But the funny thing is, I can relate to that because I started writing a book back around like 2011, 2012, because like some people don't know, I used to be a police officer. I left as a police sergeant in Philly. Yeah. And I left in 2012. And there has been a female police officer book that I've been writing since way back when I first left the police department. And I literally have been at like chapter three for the last 10 years. So
if you ever need help, let me know. You know, I like coach and mentor people through their books. Like
I didn't know that.
Girl. So if you really ever want to finish it, let me know. We will get that. We will get it done.
Nice.
Yes.
Exactly. So people can they hire you like just so like somebody watching this, if they wanted to contact you, would they be able to do that?
Yeah. Yep. So my business is Sinful Monarch. So it's C-Y-N-F-U-L.
Okay.
Monarch. And you can just Google that and my website will come up. And I have all kinds of services for authors. So I mentor, I coach, I edit, I do literally all the things. So yeah.
There you go. Exactly. And I'll link that under the video as well so everybody can contact you if they need to. I know from my perspective, I found out about ACX in 2020.
Yeah.
The reason why was because everything is shut down, the pandemic. I'm a single mom. And I was at the time, I was like doing a bunch of side hustles and doing like Uber was one of them. And when it shut down, I could like there were no daycares open or any of that stuff. Right. So I ended up watching a YouTube video and the person talked about like narrating a book. So I auditioned. You were my first audition. So literally I clicked off of that video and went for your audition and landed it. So a lot of people have like followed my journey since then because I'll fill them in. Because the funny thing is I didn't want to talk about it on my channel. That wasn't something that I ever wanted to talk about because at the time my channel was called Deal Finding Diva. Okay. So instead, like I was talking about couponing and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, I literally just left a comment on that other channel like, oh, thank you. I landed my first audition. So people came running over to my channel like, well, what does she sound like? And you know, that kind of thing. So I know from my perspective, before 2020, I had no idea what ACX was.
Yeah.
Like how long did you know about it? Did you find out about it around then?
It's so funny. I don't know if you remember, because I feel like whenever I work with a new narrator, I tell them like a little bit of my story. So I don't know if you remember, but I actually used to be a narrator as well. And so, yeah. And so so it's funny. So my story for as a, like becoming an author is kind of crazy. So it's not crazy, but it's like, it started from ACX. So I loved listening to audiobooks. I've always been a reader, but I got really into audiobooks at one point. And I was like, I could do that. You know, like I can do that. And so I looked it up. I'm like, how do you even go about this? Da da da. And yeah, it started a lot with like YouTube and stuff like that. I just studied and I did it. I bought the equipment and I did four books. And the last book that I did was actually for my pen sister, Kenya Red. And me and her just became like super close. Like that's like to this day, one of my best friends. And this was back in like 2018.
Oh, okay.
And me and her just started talking and she just started telling me about the industry. And she, you know, I was like, I'm like, I like writing. Like I have this book I haven't finished, which was The Family. Like, I'm like, you know, and then she was talking to me about like, well, you know, we could do this and this and this. And like, I came up with this whole other idea for a whole other series. And that's how I kind of got sidetracked from The Family. But yeah, so like, as soon as I was like talking to Kenya and she's around my age and I was like, I could do that. Like I did the narrating thing. Like now I can write my own book. Like I can do that. And so as soon as I started writing, I just didn't have enough, you know how long it takes to narrate an audiobook. I did not have the time to do both. And so that's how I kind of found out about ACX. And that was like really my transition into being an author myself. So that's kind of cool.
Exactly. So I take it, I'm going to assume that you like the author end better than the narrating end of it.
You know, I do. I it's my passion. Like that is my passion. That's where my love lies. I couldn't imagine not creating like in that way. But what's funny is when the pandemic happened, I actually looked back into narrating again. Like I did, like I bought the stuff and everything because I had sold all my equipment. I rebought the stuff and I just... Oh, wow. I just didn't follow through with it. I do miss it though. I miss it so, so much. I wish that I had the time and the patience to like redo it again, but I don't. And so it's hard for me to like let go of my like, you know, because you know, when you have a book, you want it to sound a certain way. And so I was always like, I could narrate my own audiobooks. Like, this is so great. Da, 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 da. But it just, it doesn't work like that for me, anyways. And so when I find those gems like you, that's why I was like, I need you to do this series. Like, I need you. Like, there's this, you know, you have a certain sound that you want. And so I do miss it in that aspect. Like, I wish that I could tap back into that because it is so much fun. It's a lot of work and it can be frustrating and hard and da 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 da, but it's so much fun. Like at the end of the day, I was just listening to part two, like before I approved it. And I was just like, oh my God, like she's having so much fun with this. I could tell. I'm like, I miss this.
In college, my major was communications and theater. So I always let people know, like, embody the characters, like, actually try to live through those characters. And the thing is, like, I just like to be able to transform to be that person that I know in real life, I'm not allowed to be her, you know? So that gives me an escape. Yeah.
Yes. No, I 1000%. And I see that when you do it, like, I would, like I said, I was listening. My favorite is when you do Aiden. I don't know why. Like, Aiden is my favorite. Like, I just be like, yes, like, that is Aiden. That's exactly how he says it. Like, yes, hands down. Like, that is, like, my favorite thing ever.
The funny thing is, I was just thinking about the different characters. And I was just like, I was literally thinking this yesterday. And I'm like, Aiden is such a jerk. At the same time, I feel like there's something about him that's somewhat lovable that is like, but he's a jerk at the same time.
Yeah, he's a jerk, but he's like our jerk. Like, we love him. And it's so funny because he's so stubborn and he just refuses to admit that he has feelings about anything. But like, We know, you know what I mean? So yeah, Aiden, you do Aiden so well.
How many books do you think that like you have in you, like that you could put down eventually? I'm looking at your reaction. I'm like,
yeah. So I have this notebook. I wish it was close, but I don't even know where it's at. But I have this notebook that is literally filled with ideas. And I mean, there's literally probably about 40 book ideas that I have like in this notebook. And I literally, so I'm actually kind of like rebranding a little bit. I just announced my publishing company on Facebook, and like, yeah, so thank you. So with that, I'm kind of like rebranding and like moving more into like a really urban. So like a lot of the ideas that I had were kind of tapping into, I don't know, like suspense and stuff like that. And not that I won't get to those ideas, but like I really want to tap into this, like keep tapping into this like really urban, like gritty street stuff. And and so I found myself actually like selling my ideas. Like I'll sell, like I'll outline them fully for authors and then can buy them.
Wow.
And because it's just like some of them I'm like, I'm not gonna use. So like the ideas are honestly endless. Like I don't feel like I'll ever like run out or stop. Like I think I have as many books in me as long as I have like breath in my body.
What are you looking for in somebody when they are auditioning for one of your audiobooks?
That's a really good question. So, okay. So I learned really kind of the hard way that you can't just pick up the first audition that you get. With my first series, I did that in like, I should have waited to see what else was out there basically. So I've learned to really practice patience, and I don't know if you narrators probably don't know, but like for authors, it's actually really hard to find narrators, really, really hard. Mm-hmm. So for some books, like I won't even get any auditions. And what? Sometimes I'll get two. Sometimes I'll get 10. Like it just depends. And so I've learned to be really like, I give it like 2-3 weeks. And sometimes if you audition for a book and it takes a while for you to like get the offer or to say like, sorry, you haven't been selected, it's because the author is doing what they're supposed to do. And they're really taking their time to see how many auditions they can get in. Because sometimes, like I said, sometimes you'll get like one and then it won't be like for a couple of weeks. Or sometimes you have to repost your book. And oh, so it's to the top of the page again so that people will, it's so anyways, to answer your question, I really have learned to take my time. And there has been times where like I've had to like repost my books like 3-4 times. It'll take me like 4 months to like find the right narrator. I just look for somebody who is very articulate, has a nice sound to their voice, someone who I know like my readers are going to leave good reviews for, because the last thing I want to do is also is like allow a narrator to narrate for my book and then the not only the book but they get bad reviews because it wasn't a good fit, especially with new narrators who don't know how hard it is. Listen,
yeah.
It's hard. And ACX doesn't make it easier because they'll allow you to submit your book and they'll be like, yay, like you did it. And then they'll come back 3 weeks later and be like, actually, you got to fix all these things. Like, what?
Yes. That so. First book, that's what did it to me. And that was why I created my course, was because I'm like, I want to save people the frustration of having to go through that, because that was like, that deflated my balloon so fast. I was like, wait, I didn't meet sound requirements. Why'd you accept it? You know? So.
Yeah. That's the annoying part with ACX. So any narrator out there, just know that like they will not approve, but they will allow you to submit your book even if your book doesn't meet. So I feel like they need to fix that. I feel like they need to be like, no, like you can't even submit this because it's not, you know what I mean? It's not up to par or whatever. But yeah, they just, it does deflate. It happened to me. And so whenever it happens to a narrator, and I always feel bad because they're always like, I'm so sorry. I don't know what I did. Like, da, da, da. And I'm like, it's okay. Like, well, you know, you just have to, like, you have to just figure out what it is that's wrong and fix it. And like, it's fine. Take your time. Don't be worried. Don't be sad or worried or whatever, but it is frustrating. Those sound requirements are so frustrating. So take her course, because listen, you will be in tears without it.
When you were narrating, like when you got your equipment, what did you get? Because I know people ask me about my equipment. What was it that you got?
Girl, I got the cheapest little microphone I could find. It was the it was a condensed microphone, but it was like, I remember it was like $25. Like but that's really all you need to get started to see if this is something that you really can do. Because trust me, baby, like you may or may not make it, and you don't want to spend $400 on a whole setup and you're like, no, absolutely not. Like, this is too hard. It's too frustrating. Like, people don't realize that narrating is more than just reading the book. Like, you want to read the book through first so you get a feel for the characters. Then you want to, you know, record, but you have to realize that you're going to make mistakes. You don't just record straight through. Like, you make mistakes, so that means you have to go back and edit. You have to master it. You have to, like, there's so many steps. It takes so much time. Like, I was telling somebody, I think that it takes about, like, if let's say the finished audiobook is like 8 hours. That is like 50 hours of work on the back end. It's not just 8 hours of work. It's a lot. And so I just got the cheapest one. And then I think it was like at book two, I ended up spending like $250, I think, on like a whole setup. So I got like the really good mic. I got the like, what do they call it? Pop filter thingy. Yeah, and I got the headphones. I got the little mixer sound thingy. Like, I was like, you know, feeling myself for a minute there. So yeah, I would really suggest just going the cheap route at first.
Like, we've never met, you know, and you're literally spot on saying all the stuff that I've been telling them for the past 3 years.
Yes.
And it's like, you know, because people will jump to, oh, I need to get this expensive microphone.
Oh, don't do it.
The thing is, like, people, a lot of times, they want to go from 0 to 100.
And I get
so it. I get people that will ask me like, oh, can I record on my cell phone? And I'm like, I wouldn't do a recording on my cell phone, but I would get a microphone. But just because I say get a microphone doesn't mean go spend $200 on the microphone that I have, you know?
No.
So you spot on nailed that, because okay. There's things in between. And the thing is, like, I made it easy for them, and I still get the questions, like, because I have an Amazon page, an Amazon storefront.
Yep.
I have a bunch of audiobook narration equipment on there where, like, from every budget, they can find something. Like, they even have microphone bundles where you can get a whole bundle which includes the microphone, the pop filter, and like maybe one other thing, like a stand and stuff for like $50.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so people need to understand that just because you're taking it seriously enough to buy equipment doesn't mean that you have to go and splurge and buy this expensive equipment.
You know this, like, it can be a struggle to get sales. Like, it's not easy. It's so hard. People don't read in the first place. And then audiobooks is like is like one of those like in-betweens. I always try to convince people, like, if you don't read a book, like, do audiobook while you're driving, while you're cleaning, while you're working, like, whatever. Like, you can listen and promise you'll be so entertained. And people just like their music and da 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 da. And I'm like, I don't know. So it can be hard to also, like, still get sales even when you know, like, all these things. So being very patient is so important in this industry. Like, as far as I'm concerned, like, any audiobook we've done is ours, because you put just as much work in as I did to create it. So promote it as such. And a lot of the sales will come from your end of promoting and trying to get readers. You know, the author will do what they can, but again, like, their readers have already probably read it already, unless there's those few that, like, only do audiobooks. But that's another thing that I think audiobook narrators don't really understand. They'll be like, oh my God, like, this is a really popular author. Like, yes, I'm going to get so many sales. And it's like, yes, that author is very popular, but you have to put the work in too.
The thing is, like, when people are auditioning, like, they aren't really thinking much about what they're auditioning for.
Yeah.
And because I know one point that I end up having to make to people is, 9 times out of 10, when they're not nailing these auditions, is because they're auditioning for the wrong book. Mm-hmm. Like they're, you know, it's just not that book for their personality or their voice or their accent.
Yep.
And yep. It's just like the you're accent. Wasting your time.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. You got to pay attention to those accents because the author will select what kind of like style or accent they want you to have. And if like I've had like British people audition for my like I'm like, I want a New York, like, you know what I mean? And I'm like, what is happening? So you have to pay attention to that. And one other gem, like on that same line, one thing that I remember hearing from, so it was like someone like you who had a course for narrating. She said, there will always be somebody who likes your voice. Even if you don't really like your voice, because I don't really like my voice, but she was
me
like,
either.
Yes. See, she was like, I promise you, there will always be a book out there for you to narrate. You just have to do it. And she was right. Like, I was so surprised that like after, I think it was my first audition too, and I got it. And I was like, what? Like, that's so, you just have to kind of like do it, you know?
Yeah. And if you ever need narrators, I have a bunch of people in my course that are always looking for audiobooks to narrate. So.
I will reach out to you. I'm so serious because it's so hard to find narrators. I will be in contact with you. Unless I'm like begging you to do another book for me. But yeah, I will definitely, because it is really hard. And I'm always willing to give new narrators a try. Like I said, as long as they're willing to see the project through, I'm always willing. So, and I have some like new series coming up, like new books, mm-hmm. new series, all that. And so I'll definitely be needing narrators. Like,
you dropped so many gems for us. And I so you just don't understand how much I appreciate you being here and taking the time out. And I know you have so much going on in your mind, just reading what I read.
Yes.
It's like, I know she got a lot going on. So I really do appreciate you taking the time out to come and talk to me and talk to my audience. Like, you are so awesome.
Thank
for this.
Thank you. I'm so happy we finally did this. We talked
to yes, you. Absolutely. Yeah. All right, so we're going to end this video. So thanks to everybody for tuning in. Make sure you check out Sin's collection. I'm going to put all her links below this video so that you can check out all of her books. The ones I narrated, the ones I didn't narrate, her regular books on Amazon, all of them, they will be down below. All right. So we're going to peace out on this video and we will see you soon.
Bye.
I might be broken down, but I'm smiling. I keep my head up high though I fail. Sometimes I get a bit emotional, but then I turn around and let it go.